morning. That's our prayer this morning, that the Holy Spirit would join here among us, that He would bless us with His presence in a way that lives are changed and that we are changed as we go out into the world next week. Let me invite you to stand with us, please, as you join with me in this prayer.
Thank you. Dad, we love you so much. Thank you for this time we have to come to just worship you and to pour our hearts and our use our voices, Father, to just lift you up. Thank you for your great love. Thank you for your spirit moving in our hearts. Thank you for fellowship and all these believers here, these brothers and sisters, Father. Let us continue to worship. Just be present today. Let us feel your spirit today. We love you. And it's in your name we pray. Amen. You guys may be seated for just a few moments. Welcome. Good morning.
Good morning.
We are so glad that you guys are here at Campbellsville Baptist Church this morning. My name is Jeremy Litton. I'm the Director of Children's Ministries here. We are so glad that you are with us. If you are a guest, we are very thankful that you have chosen to come here today. In your bulletin, you will see there's just a little tear-out sheet right there. So if you just want to rip that out, fill it out, and you can just drop that in the offering bucket whenever that gets passed around later today. Also, another quick reminder, after service today, there's a few connection points that we want to make you guys aware of. If you go right out here to the back, that's where Pastor Mike will be after the service. So if you've never met Pastor Mike or you just want to talk to him, he'll be out there in that hallway. Also, right out here in the elevator spot, there's another connection point, and also down in the gym lobby. It's just a good place for us as brothers and sisters just to connect for a little bit, take a breath, just kind of relax as we get ready for small group Bible studies. So just remember those after the service. Also, another big announcement, April 8th from 1 to 3, we have our family Easter event here at the church in the gym. It'll be a really great time for you as a family to come and enjoy some very interactive lessons and some very interactive things for you guys to do as a family, just to learn a little bit more about the Easter story and just to kind of come together and spend the afternoon together as a family. So, during this time, we're going to have our meet and greet. So everyone's going to stand and kind of greet each other. But during this time, if you are a kid of any age, we're going to have our children's sermon right after that. So you guys can just kind of make your way down. Again, we're so thankful that you guys are here this morning. So let's stand and greet one another.
All right. Can everybody see me? Well, good morning. Y'all got to answer me. Good morning.
Good morning.
All right. I'm Brad. I'm the discipleship pastor. So if you didn't know that, that's who I am. Okay. I got a question for you this morning. Do you know what it means to make a choice? Or what does the word choice mean? Somebody help me out. It means to pick between two things or two or more things, right? Okay, so I'm going to, in Isaiah 7:15, it says, he knows enough to refuse evil and choose good. In other words, God gives us the ability to choose between right and wrong. So to prove this, we're gonna take a little test here, okay? I'm going to ask you some questions, and you're going to answer. Got it? Okay. You see someone walking down the street, and a $10 bill falls out of their pocket. What do you do? Do you go and pick it up and put it in your pocket, or do you go get it and take it back to them? You take it back to them. Anybody else want to put it in their pocket and keep it? You want to, but that's not the right thing to do. Good. All right. Now, there's another thing. Okay, your mom has this special vase that she has on your kitchen table that always has flowers in it. Okay? And if you're like me, when you were a kid, you were told not to play with balls in the house, but you ended up playing with balls in the house. My mom has no memories of that time period. My brother and I played with balls in the house. They're all destroyed. But okay, so you're playing ball in the house, and the ball accidentally hits that big vase, her favorite vase, and it falls, crashes to the floor, and it shatters. But at the same time, your mom hears that. She sees a cat running out of the kitchen. So here's the choice. Do you let the cat take the fall for the vase, or do you come clean? Come clean. Come clean. Because you know what? She knows it wasn't a cat. All right, last one. You go in your brother or sister's room, and you see their iPad or their tablet, and you grab it, and you start playing on it, and you accidentally drop it. The screen shatters or cracks. What do you do? Do you try to hide it back where it was and turn it upside down and try to hide it so that they won't, so your brother or sister will think that they accidentally did it? Or do you confess? All right, so y'all made some really good choices this morning. But remember, one of the choices we have to make is to always be in God's Word, because that is where God tells us what is right and wrong and will give us the tools to make positive choices, okay? Well, let's pray. God, we thank you for today. We thank you that you're a God that teaches us each and every day to make choices. You teach us to make the choice between right and wrong. And God, I pray that even today as we sit in worship or as we go to XP or as we when we go home this afternoon, that we will make choices that honor you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, those of you who are singing here in just a second, I need you to stay here. Those who are not singing, if you'll go back to your seats, okay?
Created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God.
Design.
It's wonderful to hear children remind us that God has a plan, He has a purpose, He has something that He wants for each one of us. A part of that is to come into worship together as a part of the body. It's much more than that, but that is at least a part, and we are here doing that today. So, you know, part of the reason we can do that is because of a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. He saves us. He has that plan. He has that future. Let's stand together as we continue to worship.
The hush of mercy breathing, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. Hear the host of angels sing, glory to the newborn King, and the sounding joy redeeming, Jesus saves.
The humblest hearts adore Him, Jesus saves, Jesus saves, and the wisest bow before Him, Jesus saves, Jesus saves. See the sky alive with praise, melting darkness in its place.
Glory to His name. Glory to His name. those children that would like to go to Kids XP, which is a worship experience specifically for the children, we're going to ask them to follow Mr. Jeremy out. And for the rest of you, let me ask you to be seated, please. Over the last 3 weeks, we've been listening to testimonies, people sharing their heart about what their piece of the puzzle, where do they fit in here at Campbellsville Baptist Church? You see, because each one of us has a place that we can fill in. We have a place that God has for us to serve, and we've been listening to these testimonies. So as these children leave, and we're going to let them get out so that we don't put them in the dark, I'm going to ask you to give attention to this next person that shares what their piece of the puzzle is here at Campbellsville Baptist.
I am Betty Ray Moss, and I've been attending this church since I was carried here by my parents. Later, I made profession of faith and was baptized in spring of 1940, which is 77 years. Much of that time, I attended along with my late husband, Hugh. We raised our family in this church. In the area of service, I feel like I need to be faithful in attendance to a worship service and to contribute my tithe to help with the ongoing ministries done by this church. I've also been privileged to work with preschool Sunday school since better than 60 years, and been able to watch many of them grow up to come to accept Jesus and be baptized. In thinking of signing times in the church, the first Sunday we had worship in our present sanctuary, I well remember the first hymn we sang, "To God Be the Glory," and it certainly was to His glory. Also, as we built the Christian Life Center, it certainly was to God's glory as well. And then it was very exciting to see our two girls make profession and be baptized in our church. And we've had some musical programs that have been outstanding in the production of Alleluia, and then several years of doing the Easter pageant, which were well attended by the community as well as our church. We all received a blessing from those. Well, first of all, in thinking of the prayer for coming years, we need to thank God for the blessings of the past years, how He's blessed this church. But in thinking of coming years, we would ask for growth so that we might have more people to help in winning souls and changing lives. My name is Betty Ray Moss, and that is my piece of the puzzle.
Amen. Great testimony this morning. We are really appreciating those series of videos, and we want to thank Robert Bender and Elijah Coffey and other volunteers that help make those videos a reality for us in these days. Let me ask you to take your Bibles this morning and turn to the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew chapter 27, going to be this morning in Matthew 27, verses 1 to 26. Give you a moment just to find that, Matthew 27, verses 1 to 26. Now, as you're finding that passage this morning, let me just give you another quick update on our capital campaign, Our Church, His Glory. And this information is in your worship bulletin this morning, but I also want to highlight for all of us this morning, again, Our Church, His Glory is a capital campaign to improve the stewardship of our building as we seek to reach people for Christ in our community and around the world. So you see here where we are as of this morning. Our amount pledged and given so far, $50,445 for an overall goal of $304,000. This is, again, a two-year commitment, and from the first Sunday of March till this Sunday, this is a good way to chart our progress. Let me also point this out. If you have not yet been able to turn in a commitment card for the campaign, you can still do that. For the past few Sundays in March, we've been making the commitment card available in the worship bulletin. If you'll just just take a look in your bulletin this morning. Go ahead and pull it out. And if you notice on the tear-out section, on one side we've got the connection card for our visitors, but on the other side we do have a reproduction of the commitment card. And so if you have not yet been able to turn one of these in, you can do so today. Fill that out, place it in the offering plate later in the service. And to commit to the campaign really is the best way to support this effort. And of course, you'll also notice the information in the bulletin this morning about the Andy Armstrong offering for North American missions, and we would prayerfully support that effort as well. And also, just a reminder about our new schedule and how well it's been working out. Worship at 9, Sunday school at 10:30. Please remember that when this worship service ends, at 10:30 we'll begin our small groups for Bible study. There is a place for every single one of us this morning in a small group. And if you are looking for a place to connect, then our pastors will be at three different CBC Connect stations. I'll be at the station that is at the corner of the hallway outside this rear door of the worship center. We'll also have pastors at the Connect station that is outside of this exit, and we'll have pastors at the Connect station that is in the Christian Life Center foyer. We do have a new Sunday school class starting this morning. There's information about that in your bulletin, but Dr. Charles Hedrick will be beginning a Sunday morning small group. There's information about that group, where it meets, but again, Dr. Hedrick, we're happy that you're able to start this Bible study group for us this morning. Doctor, if you want to stand and let us know who you are. Dr. Charles Hedrick, again, thank you, Dr. Hedrick, for your willingness to do this for us. CBC Connect, CBC Gather. Again, just a reminder, we do have refreshments available in the Fellowship Hall and in the Christian Life Center in between the end of worship and the start of Sunday school at 10:30. Matthew 27, verses 1 to 26. If you'll please stand in honor of God's word, follow along as I read aloud. Matthew 27, beginning at verse 1. When morning came, all the chief priests and elders of the people took counsel against Jesus to put him to death. And they bound him and led him away and delivered him over to Pilate, the governor. Then when Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he changed his mind and brought back the 30 pieces of silver to the chief priests and the elders, saying, "I've sinned by betraying innocent blood." They said, "What is that to us? See to it yourself." And throwing down the pieces of silver into the temple, he departed, and he went and hanged himself. But the chief priest, taking the pieces of silver, said, "It is not lawful to put them into the treasury, since it is blood money." So they took counsel and bought with them the potter's field as a burial place for strangers. And then to verse 11. Now Jesus stood before the governor, and the governor asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus said, "You've said so." But when he was accused by the chief priests and the elders, he gave no answer. And then Pilate said to him, "Do you not hear how many things they testify against you?" But he gave him no answer, not even to a single charge, so that the governor was greatly amazed. And now at the feast, the governor was accustomed to release for the crowd any one prisoner whom they wanted, and they then had a notorious prisoner called Barabbas. So when they had gathered, Pilate said to them, "Whom do you want me to release for you, Barabbas or Jesus who is called Christ?" For he knew that it was out of envy that they had delivered him up. Besides, while he was sitting on the judgment seat, his wife sent word to him, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, for I have suffered much because of him today in a dream." Now the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and destroy Jesus. The governor again said to them, "Which of the two do you want me to release for you?" And they said, "Barabbas." Pilate said to them, "Then what shall I do with Jesus who is called Christ?" And they all said, "Let him be crucified." And he said, "Why, what evil has he done?" And they shouted all the more, "Let him be crucified." So when Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water and washed his hands before the crowd, saying, "I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves." And all the people answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." And then he released for them Barabbas, and having scourged Jesus, delivered him to be crucified. You may be seated. When I was 11 years old, I persuaded my parents to allow me to do something that they had never allowed me to do before. I had assembled many models, model planes, model cars, model trucks. But for every model that I assembled, I never painted them. Because my parents would say, well, you know, just put the models together, they'll be fine. But don't worry about painting them because, quite frankly, what if something happened with the paint and what if it stained the floor of your room or your desk and so forth? Just put the models together and that'll be enough. But when I was 11 years old, I was given a model car for my birthday, and as I began to assemble the car together, I said, could I paint this one? Mom looked at Dad, Dad looked at Mom, and Dad said, well, you know what, you're 11 years old, sure, let's do this. So I went out and bought the paint, a small jar of it, and there it was on my desk, and there the parts of the car were ready to be assembled. I thought, you know what, let's not do this on top of my desk, let me do this on the floor just in case. So I took the components of the model, put them on the floor, put the jar of model paint on the floor, and then thought to myself, I had better spread out some newspapers. And so when I got up to get some newspapers, my foot tipped the jar, and all of the model paint spilled on the floor of my room. So I went and told my dad. And instead of getting upset or angry, or instead of saying, I told you so, Dad said, you know what, Mike, real quick, before that paint has a chance to dry, let's get some paper towels, let's get some newspapers that you've got there, let's clean this up quickly before it dries. And that's exactly what we did. Now, in all fairness to my parents, they did not say, go out and buy more paint. I just put the model together. But that jar of paint became to means so much for me because it was part of growing up, part of taking responsibility for what I had done, for mistakes that were made, owning up to them, as Brad so eloquently shared in the children's sermon earlier in the service today. The paint in the jar was one thing, but once that paint was spilled, it meant something far more, even something unexpected. The passage before us this morning in Matthew 27 is about the death of Jesus. And I want us to approach these verses with reverence, with worship. They are some of the deepest and most serious words that we'll find in all of Scripture. But I want us today to focus on what these verses tell us about the blood of Jesus. Now, Scripture teaches that Jesus, being fully God and fully man, yes, because he was man, because he was human, he had blood coursing through his veins. He had blood in his veins, and the thought of the blood of Jesus, even in his veins, beating through his heart, that would be marvelous enough. And yet Matthew 27 tells us that there was a day when that blood was spilled. That precious blood was shed. Innocent blood was shed. And I want to share with you this morning how the shed blood of Jesus affects every single one of us this morning. In fact, the shed blood of Jesus does two things for every single one of us here today. And if you'll look with me in Matthew 27, I want to show you the two things that the shed blood of Jesus does for every single one of us. And here's the first one. The shed blood of Jesus reveals sin. You know, when we were looking here at these verses in Matthew 27, as familiar as these events may be to many of us already, still, to look at them with fresh new eyes, particularly at the power of the shed blood of Jesus to reveal sin. We first of all start out with Judas because, in fact, we have four people in this chapter, and all of them are affected by the blood of Jesus in the same way that you and I are affected by it today. But think with me about the first person in this story, and that would be Judas. Judas the betrayer. Judas, the one who tried to cover up what he was doing. And when you read these verses about Judas, and when you find out that in fact he reached a point where he realized that things were happening that he was not planning on, things were happening that were a surprise to him, we think, well, what was happening with Judas all along? And I believe that Judas was a group of the 12, and yes, he did betray Jesus, but you think about what he was wanting to see. And I believe that Judas was one of many people in Jesus' day who were looking for a revolution. Judas was looking for a political revolution, an economic and social revolution. He was looking for those Roman occupiers to be overthrown and cast out, and for the Jewish people to once again regain complete control of their lives and of their land. And Judas invested all of those expectations in Jesus. And as much as Jesus would teach his disciples and say, look, I am not that kind of savior. Jesus said, I am not a political savior or an economic savior. Jesus said, I am the deepest kind of savior that you need. I have come to save you from hell, to save you from your sins. So therefore, Jesus said, I will be given over to my enemies. They will kill me. And 3 days later, I'll rise again. Judas didn't hear that because he didn't want to hear it. And so in his mind, he hatched a plot that said, let's hurry things up, because if Jesus is not willing to create this revolution, Judas said, then I'll create it for him. I'll manage to get him handed over to the authorities, and when the people see it, they will rise up. They will not stand to see this innocent man charged. The people will rise up and this revolution will begin. So Judas betrayed him and he handed him over. And the blood of this innocent man revealed that sin. Matthew 27, beginning at verse 3, when Judas, his betrayer, saw that Jesus was condemned, he changed his mind. He brought back the 30 pieces of silver. He said, look, can we just redo this? I don't want this money anymore. And the people that gave him the money said, well, we don't want it. We don't want anything to do with that money because it has been tainted. It is blood money. It has been used to betray an innocent man. And Judas went out to hang himself. The blood of Jesus revealed the sin of the betrayer. The man who betrayed the trust, the man who betrayed friendship and loyalty and love, the man who said one thing, but in his heart he was hatching a plot of betrayal and a plot of hatred. The blood of Jesus revealed that. Notice someone else who was affected by the blood of Jesus. Look at Pilate this morning. Because Pilate is trying to decide what to do with Jesus. The text makes very clear that Jesus is standing before Pilate, a condemned man. The Jewish authorities had brought charges against Jesus, but as Pilate hears the case, Pilate realizes that standing before him is a man who has done nothing wrong. He is an innocent man. And so Pilate tries to reason with the Jewish authorities. Why are you handing this man over for crucifixion? What has he done? He's done nothing to deserve it. So the Jewish authorities say he claims to be the king of the Jews. And so if he claims to be the king of the Jews, then therefore he is a threat to Caesar. Therefore he has charges, things that he has done that merit execution. He is an enemy of the state. And so Pilate says, Jesus, is it true? Are you the king of the Jews? And Jesus answers Pilate, well, you have said so. But any accusation from the Jewish leaders, he will not answer. So Pilate is stuck. Will he allow an innocent man to be executed? Now, the Roman law, the Roman statutes would have protected an innocent man. The Roman legal system, what was the epitome, the pinnacle of legal systems. In fact, our legal system today is based so much on Roman law because it is to protect the innocent. So there was plenty that Pilate could have done to protect this man. But instead, as the Bible says, he sees the people rising up. He sees a riot beginning. He wants to, in some way, placate the Jewish authorities to maintain peace in the land, but he doesn't want the guilt of an innocent man on his conscience. And then to add to it, his wife sends him word that she's been tormented in her dreams because she knows, and everyone knows, that Jesus is a righteous man. And so what does Pilate do? He tries so desperately to get out of the corner that he is in. The scriptures tell us that the Pilate himself, a few years prior, had started a custom with the Jews. During the Passover week, the custom was that any condemned prisoner could be set free. Amnesty, a way to try to ease tension in that city of Jerusalem. Rather, Pilate had said, I will release any man that you choose. It's the man that you choose. And so once again, you realize the cunning of this. If the people decide a prisoner to be released, and if that prisoner goes on to commit more crimes, the Roman authorities can say, well, we released the person that you decided. So Pilate thinks, well, here is my out. Here is my out. Surely the people will not want Jesus to be crucified because we also have Barabbas here. Barabbas, the notorious criminal. Barabbas, the well-known criminal. The desperate criminal, Barabbas. So Pilate knows. He just knows that, you know what, if I put before them Barabbas or Jesus, there is no way they would choose Jesus. No way they'll ever do that. But to Pilate's disappointment, when he places before them the notorious criminal Barabbas or the innocent man Jesus, the crowd chooses Jesus. Pilate is still stuck. And notice what he says in verse 24. When Pilate saw that he was gaining nothing, but rather that a riot was beginning, he took water, he washed his hands before the crowd, saying, notice at the end of verse 24, I am innocent of this man's blood. See to it yourselves. The very same words that the Roman authorities said to Judas. We don't want that money back, Judas. It's blood money. See to it yourself. Pilate says to the crowd, I want nothing to do with this man. I don't want his blood on my conscience. See to it yourself. But the irony is, the blood of Jesus reveals Pilate's sin. A man who compromised his own integrity to please the crowd. A man who was so scared and frightened of the opinion of others that he compromised what he knew was right. It revealed his sin. But then we have a third group here in the story, and that's these Jewish leaders, these Jewish elders, these priests and these chief priests and elders. Again, the people who knew the scriptures, the people who were leading others in the worship of God and the study of God's word. And these were the ones who led the opposition. They took counsel against Jesus. They had no authority to execute a man. They had no authority to kill a man, but the Roman authorities did. So what did they do? They trump up the charges. They make some way to get the charges to stick against Jesus. And then what do? They circulate amongst the crowd. They get the crowd going. Crucify him. Crucify him. They use others. They exploit others. Meanwhile, they shield themselves from any blame. And they have others carry out their evil plan. And yet the blood of Jesus reveals their sin. I want you to understand this about the blood of Jesus. Because what it did for Judas and what it did for Pilate and what it did for the Jewish leaders, every single one of these in the story try to hide themselves. They try to do one thing and yet escape it in some way, to cover up in some way. And yet the powerful agent that is the blood of Jesus reveals what they have done. But please know that the blood of Jesus is still doing it in our lives today. Because the precious, innocent, loving man of God, Jesus Christ, went to the cross, not because of his sins, but because of my sins and because of your sins. And believe me, if there ever was any scenario where you and I never ever sinned, then Jesus would not have had to have died. But because of the great and amazing love of the Lord God for us, and because of God's desire to repair the relationship and do something for us that we could not do for ourselves, Jesus died. But make no mistake, my sins put him there. And your sins put him there. And whenever you think of a picture of Jesus Christ on the cross, as disturbing as that picture is, I want you to imagine yourself there. At the foot of the cross, not kneeling and not adoring, but imagine yourself at the foot of the cross holding a nail and a hammer. Because that's why he went. For my sin and for your sin. Because isn't it true today that we still do the same things? Isn't it true today that you and I still betray one against the other? Isn't it true that today, all too common, we find ourselves or we find our leaders using and exploiting others for their gain and for their plots and for their machinations? Isn't it true today that we still lie and exploit others? It still happens. And it's the blood of Jesus that reveals it. Not just an innocent man, but the Son of Man. The blood of Jesus reveals sin. True for Judas, true for Pilate, true for those leaders. But you know what? There's a fourth person in this story. And the blood of Jesus has affected his life as well. And it goes so much deeper and farther than revealing sin, although this is where it starts. But I want you to think with me about Barabbas. Again, Barabbas was there in prison. Barabbas was in prison because he deserved it. Matthew simply says that he is a notorious criminal. And I want you to think with me today about criminals that you know of that are notorious. What does a person have to do, not just to be a criminal, but to be a notorious criminal, well-known criminal, even a famous criminal? Al Capone, Charles Manson, El Chapo, take your pick. Think of criminals who are infamous for what they've done. That's Barabbas. And so Pilate places the choice before the people. A renowned, infamous, notorious criminal, or Jesus who is called the Christ. Now listen, when the crowds chose Christ, an innocent man was condemned to die. And a notorious criminal was set free. Listen, he was set scot-free. He was set free that very day. No fine, no further imprisonment that very day. The shackles were taken off, the door was unlocked, and a notorious, infamous, known criminal walked out of prison that day. But listen, Barabbas is me, and Barabbas is you. And if ever you and I think, well, Pastor Mike, how could you say that? I'm no criminal. I'm no infamous criminal. I'm no notorious criminal. I haven't done anything that you've mentioned those other people have done. How can you say I am a notorious criminal? Listen, unless you and I see us in the same place as Barabbas, we don't get it. Because every single one of us is condemned. Every single one of us is a notorious criminal on death row, deserving what we have. But please understand what the blood of Jesus did that day. Because not only does it reveal sin, but the blood of Jesus also forgives sin. Because Barabbas walked out a free man, and the precious blood of the Lord Jesus Christ cleanses you and cleanses me from every sin. It washes away every sin. It not only exposes our sin, but the blood of Jesus is given in exchange for our sin. And as the scriptures teach us in Romans 3, there is no one righteous, there is no not one. All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and yet God himself has put forth the life of his Son. The blood of Jesus Christ is our expiation. The blood of Jesus Christ is our propitiation. It pays the price. It's the punishment that we deserve. And it forgives sin. That's the power of this blood. You'll remember with me just a few years ago when the news was dominated by the power of blood, but not so much the power of Jesus' blood, but the power of blood to do far more damaging and detrimental things. Remember just a few years ago when the Ebola virus was raging around the globe and when it was taking so many lives in Africa, and it was all because of contact with the blood of Ebola victims. And all the precautions that had to be taken to care for Ebola victims, and also to take care of homes where people had died of Ebola because there could be no contact with that blood, none whatsoever. But do you also know why Ebola has been battled so successfully? It's because of blood. Specifically, the blood of Ebola survivors. It all began with Dr. Rick Brantley. Kent Brantley. Kent was the first American diagnosed with Ebola in July of 2014. His condition was worsening before he was flown back to the United States, but as he began to recover from Ebola, he himself gave a unit of his own blood to be transfused into someone else, and that turned out to be the key. After his recovery in August of 2014, Brantley kept donating his blood. He kept donating his plasma. And so soon, his colleague in Samaritan's Purse, Dr. Rick Sacra, overcame Ebola because of Kent Brantley's blood transfusion. And then Ashoko Muko, who also worked with him in Liberia, when she received a transfusion, she recovered. Dallas nurse Nina Pham also, when she received blood from Kent Brantley, she recovered. The power of blood to heal and the power of blood to set free. It still works and it's still true. So, how has God's word connected with you this morning? Please understand that even if the Holy Spirit has been convicting you today of sin in your life and sin in my life, and the Holy Spirit will do this, but please understand, if the Holy Spirit has been convicting you of sin, it means that he is at work in your life, and that in and of itself is a grace of the Lord. It means that God is calling you to him. But please know this, that same blood that reveals your sin has also released you from that sin. The blood of Jesus shed for you and for me. Father, we thank you this morning for the power of this blood. Nothing but the blood of Jesus will ever do. Nothing but the blood of Jesus will ever work for our forgiveness and for our redemption. And Lord, you tell us in your word that blood can speak. The blood of Abel spoke from the ground. The writer to the Hebrews said that the blood of Jesus speaks an even better word than the blood of Abel. And so this morning, Lord, may we hear that word and know that we have been forgiven by the shed blood of Jesus. It's up to us to trust it. It's up to us to place our faith in it. But Father, again, by the movement of your Holy Spirit, may we this morning trust totally and completely of this deliverance and this redemption. And for it, we give you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. As we stand together and sing, would you come this morning and receive this new life because of the shed blood of Christ for you, as we stand together.
Would you sing with us, please?
I am thine, O Lord. I have heard your voice and it told your Consecrate me now to your service, Lord, by the power of grace divine. Let my soul look up with a steadfast hope, and my will be lost in thine. Draw me
with me as the ushers come forward. Father, thank you, God, for being here this morning, for the word that we just heard, God, that as we approach Easter, as it's coming, God, may this message not just ring true in this season, but all year, God, as we talk about the blood and what that did for us, what it can do for us. And God, we pray this morning as we give our tithes and offerings that the blood that you shed for us is at the forefront of everything we give back and everything that we do. Penetrate our hearts, God. Allow us to focus on you in everything we do, no matter what is going on around us. We give this time to you. Bless these tithes and these offerings. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
On a hill, darkness was awakened by a hammer's ring, by a suffering king.
Sorrow ruled the day, a savior would be broken by the sting of death. He'd take his final breath.
But just when all hope seemed lost, the earth began to move, for in that moment heaven's love broke through. 'Cause he went the distance, he found a way. Mercy's persistence drew him to the cross, where he would say, such debt of grace he chose to pay for all my sin.
Such debt of grace he chose to pay so life could win.
If he can hang the stars, then he can shine the light of grace to where you are, to where you are.
And if he can calm the seas, then he can send his healing waters to bring you
please. Again, we are giving all of our praise and glory to the Lord this morning for His amazing grace. Thank you, Cole and Melissa, all of our musicians, choir, and orchestra this morning for just a great time of praise. All right, listen, we've had a great day in worship. Scott is going to come and have our benediction, but remember that Sunday school begins at 10:30, so you've got some time. Refreshments, fellowship hall, CLC foyer. I'll be at the CBC Connect station right down this hallway. We have staff members at other Connect stations as well. Love to have a chance to get to know you better and help you find your place at Connect for Bible study at 10:30. Scott.
Pastor. Would you pray with me? Father, thanks for a great morning of worship. God, thank you that we can lift up our voices. Thank you that we can have our hearts filled as your Spirit inhabits this place. God, as we leave this morning, as we go to Bible study, Lord, as every one of us probably today will eat lunch, remind us, God, we're not just eating once a week. Remind us to take in your presence every day, to be in your word every day, to trust your Spirit every day. And as we leave this place, Father, may you go with us in ways that are very personal and very tangible. In the name of Jesus, we pray. Amen.